Hi folks, welcome back again this week. Well, if you watched last week's video, we talked about the spirit of judgment. And the breaking of the seal of the fifth church. The seal, of course, is what keeps people blind to what it's talking about. That's what all of the seals are. If something is sealed, it means it's closed in, you know, closed up, hidden. So the fifth spirit, of course, remember the sevenfold spirit of God? The fifth spirit is the spirit of judgment. And we're talking about the judgment of God. And the judgment of God, well, understanding the judgment of God opens the abyss, doesn't it? Where we see the end of wickedness, how it comes about, and we understand what wickedness truly is. The sixth seal, it starts in Revelation 9:13, and that's what we're going to be discussing today. It's not going to agree, what I tell you is not going to agree with what mainstream whoredom tells you. I use the word whoredom because organized religion is the great whore. And she thinks she knows everything. She's got it all figured out. But she only deals with the literal. She has no even comprehension of the spiritual side of wisdom. So all of her wisdom comes from her knowledge of good and evil, whereby the wisdom of God comes from His Word. We use the Bible to interpret the Bible. We don't need Webster's Dictionary. We don't need science. All we need is the Word of God. And He's very, very good at explaining what He's talking about. And the spiritual wisdom is fully reliant on the entire Word of God, not on bits and pieces. The knowledge of good and evil relies on bits and pieces. But the spiritual understanding is totally reliant on everything revealing. So we need a minimum of two or three witnesses to explain. And we have to keep in mind what we learn. It's like a little kid in grade one does not understand what an adult or a juvenile understands in grade 12. They don't have the same level of understanding. It's not that they're both not committed to understanding, but there's a big difference between the two. And the one in grade 12 is going to be a failure if that individual does not remember what it was taught in grade 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way up. If he doesn't remember what he's been taught, he's going to be a failure. This is what holds kids back in school, where a child fails a grade. It's because they do not remember what they've been taught. And it may, and often, they started putting kids into the next grade, whether they failed or not. They started that quite a few decades ago, and it's been very detrimental. There are kids today in college and university who don't understand concepts that they should have learned when they were in grade one. Isn't that sad? You've got kids today that can't even do the multiplication and division table. They need a computer. You've got kids that don't understand history. They scream and yell about things they have no idea what they're talking about. And it's because they haven't been taught and they haven't remembered what they've been taught. So in the spiritual, I warn everyone, if you forget stuff, that the Lord has said in other books of the Bible, in previous areas of a chapter or a book, you're going to fail. It's the whole Word of God. Man does not live on bread alone, but by every word which proceeds from the mouth of God. So keep that in mind. Starting with Revelation 9:13, the sixth angel sounded his trumpet, and I heard a voice coming from the horns of the golden altar that is before God. Let's just stop right there. What's it talking about? What are horns in Scripture?
Strengths. What's the footnote say?
Footnote? Projections. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm sorry, that's not correct. Horns always represent strength. Always. What is the golden altar that is before God? Well, can you hand me that little picture right there? There is the golden altar that stands before God. What reveals the image and the likeness and the form in its full maturity, in its completeness? What reveals perfection in a man? Well, number one, he has to possess the four horns, the four strengths of the altar. And those four strengths are maturity in the north, vision in the west, creativity in the south, and authority in the east. If he's missing any one, he's incomplete. He's not cutting the mustard, so to speak. You can have a person who has great authority. Look at the thug standing down at the corner on the street. Everybody's afraid of him. And he can be very creative. And he can have a vision of ruling the world. If he doesn't have maturity, he's got nothing. His authority is corrupt. His vision is corrupt. And his creativity, the what he does to make things he wants happen, is corrupt. It doesn't really get much easier to explain, does it? And the same thing works if you're lacking creativity. You're corrupt. If you lack vision, you're corrupt. You're incomplete. The horns of the golden altar demand the four. Again, maturity in the north, the oxen in the north, the eagle in the west, vision, to look ahead, to look beyond the end of your nose. Or, when we're looking for the spiritual understanding of what God's telling us, to look beyond the little verse we're reading and look at all the other verses as well. Remember the whole Word of God. Well, if you don't have the vision to do that, to remember and apply the things you've already learned from the past, don't tell me that you're complete, because you're not. You lack the four horns of the golden altar. Remember the image of God? We've discussed this in previous videos. The image of God has to do with the mind. It is the ability to recognize and separate truth from falsehood. God from the devil has nothing to do with good and evil. It is the ability of the mind to think logically, to reason and separate and divide truth from falsehood. The image of God, or I should say the likeness of God, excuse me, has to do with the heart, the feeling, the emotion. Remember, the image has to do with logic up here. But the likeness has to do with emotion. The ability to choose to love or to hate. People say, oh, we should never hate because God is love. Love is love. Bullshit. That's all I can say to you people who think that way. You're full of shit. It says God is love in the scriptures. Yes, it does say that. Read a little more of that book and the rest of the book, and you find that love is the spirit of truth. So love is the spirit of God. Love is not God. So God can be love, yes. But love is not God.
And it never says that either.
Nowhere. Nowhere does it even imply that love is God. So when you see these signs, love is love, boy, beware. That's not of God. That's pure bullshit. Ignorant people putting forth their ideas. They're locusts. So the image and likeness, I'll repeat it again. The image has to do with the mind and the ability to choose to reason and separate truth from falsehood, God from the devil. The likeness of God has to do with the heart, the emotion, and the ability to choose to love or to hate. And don't forget, love starts with loving God. It does not start with loving your neighbor. It starts with loving God. If you don't love God, you haven't got a clue how to love your neighbor. It's that simple. Four horns of the golden altar. Don't forget what that's talking about. It said to the sixth angel, an angel is a
messenger
who had the trumpet, a call to pay attention, release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates. Uh-oh. What's the Euphrates? Remember the river of life flowed out of the garden? It was one river in the garden. But it divides, it separates into four rivers when it leaves the garden. And the four rivers are the Euphrates, the Tigris, the Gihon, and the Pishon. Those are the four rivers that flow out of the garden. The garden is paradise. It's perfection. Remember what we're talking about today? The things we've already said? Can you remember? What is perfection? The four horns of the golden altar? that stands before God?
Displaying all the characteristics of each of the four living creatures.
Exactly. Exactly. The ox in the north.
Maturity.
The eagle in the west.
Vision.
The lion in the east.
Authority.
And the man in the south.
Creativity.
Release the four angels bound at the great river Euphrates. What then is the Euphrates? The four rivers represent these four horns. Which one is the Euphrates? Let me help you. Look at that one right there. Do you see at the bottom? Euphrates? It's the eagle, isn't it? The red horse. And what does the red horse represent?
War.
I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Remember the rider on the red horse in the book of Revelation? Everybody, lots of people seem to think that's of the devil. Excuse me? What's in his hand? A sword. And what's the sword of God? Remember, it's coming from the four horns. What's the sword of God?
It's his word.
His word. Release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates. Oh boy. And the four angels who had been kept ready for this very hour and day and month and year were released to kill a third of mankind. The number of the mounted troops was 200 million. It's not really that big a number, is it, when you compare it to 7.8 billion? It's not really that great, is it? I heard their number. The horses and riders I saw in my vision looked like this. Their breastplates were fiery red, dark blue, and yellow as sulfur. Let's look at these colors. Red represents
War.
Blue represents
Peace.
But they're dark blue. Darkness represents
ignorance.
And yellow represents
Cowardice.
The heads.
Also, because I'm going to forget, and I think it's important. It starts describing four angels, and then it switches to saying four. Where does it go?
Keep going.
Horses and riders.
Yeah.
So the angels are
the horses.
Yes,
and riders.
Yes, it's not separate. It's.
That's right.
That's what they are.
An angel is a messenger. So these angels that are coming forth, they're horses. That which carries the message, and rider. And their breastplates were fiery red. They want to make war. Dark blue. They're truly ignorant of peace. Because God's not in it. And yellow is sulfur. They're cowards. They need backup, and lots of it. They only have strength in numbers. The heads of the horses resembled the heads of lions. Remember, the lion represents authority, this one? And out of their mouths came fire. What is the fire? Of God.
The truth revealed.
The truth revealed. What is the fire of man? Man's opinions revealed. Smoke? You remember last week's video on smoke? The locusts? Remember smoke and mirrors? I'm going to let you go. Maybe it'll encourage some of you to go back and watch that last week's video again. Learn what these things are. If you don't know what they are, you're not going to understand what this is talking about. It's that simple. Fire, smoke, and sulfur. Now, in other translations, that word sulfur is brimstone. What did God rain down on Sodom and Gomorrah? Fire and brimstone. Remember it said, where was it? It's back up a little bit. Yellow as sulfur. Sulfur is brimstone. Yellow, cowardice. Remember I talked to you about how people are, they're cowards when they're by themselves. But when they're with their gang, whoo, you know, toute la gang, as they say in Quebec. You fight me and my gang. Alone, they're nothing. But together, a third of mankind was killed by the three plagues of fire, smoke, and sulfur. Boy, is that important to understand that. A third of mankind is killed. Now, that can be physical death, but more importantly, it's spiritual death. Death of the mind and heart. That came out of their mouths. It's all coming out of their mouths. The power of the horses was in their mouths. That's where their power is in their words. And in their tails. Now, do you remember last week's video again? We talked about tails. Isaiah 9, 14 and 15. The prophets who teach lies are the tails. The power of horses was in their mouths and in their tails, and their tails were like snakes, like serpents, venomous serpents. Remember it says you will pick up serpents and drink deadly poison and it won't harm you if you're in Christ. What is it talking about? They had a show on TV a few years back, Rattlesnake Preachers or something like that. And there are people in the States, probably in other nations as well, they love to test God. they pick up, go out and round up a bunch of rattlesnakes and bring them into their meetings and dance with them and play with them and everything. And if they get bit, they don't go and get anything done for themselves medically. Because they believe that the word says you will handle deadly serpents. Well, it was a very popular show until the main character, who was the preacher and leader of this group of snake charmers, got bit by a rattlesnake and died. You can't fix stupid, can you? You just can't fix stupid. Jesus called the Pharisees and Sadducees a bunch of serpents, spewing their poison, their lies, and yet people think, oh, well, I can drink arsenic and it won't hurt me. Yeah, until you die. You tell your kid it's okay, you can drink it. Your kid believes you, drinks it, and dies. And then you say, well, it was God's will. No, it wasn't. It was your will that killed your child. Certainly wasn't God's will that your child die. There's consequence to being an idiot. Stupidity invites consequence. And consequence is the wrath of God, and God is truth, who preaches love, and yet you'd feed your child arsenic and think you're doing something unbelievable. Unbelievable. The tails were like snakes, having heads with which they inflict injury. Now this is important. Back to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 14 and 15. Look it up for us, honey. We'll read it again this week because I'm sure there are many are not paying attention.
Where is it?
9:14, Isaiah.
So the Lord will cut off from Israel both head and tail, both palm branch and reed in a single day. The elders and prominent men are the head. The prophets who teach lies are the tail.
Their tails were like snakes having heads. The tails have heads with which they inflict injury. And the heads are?
Elders and prominent men.
The elders and prominent men who have authority over the lying prophets. Wow. The rest of mankind that were not killed by these plagues still did not repent of the work of their hands. They did not stop worshiping demons.
False ideas.
False ideas. And idols of gold, silver, and bronze, stone, and wood. Idols that cannot see or hear, or walk, they will not stop worshiping their mammon. Everything that a person values more than God. God is supposed to be our manna, but they worship mammon. And it's all the crap. Nor did they repent of their murders, their magic arts, their sexual immorality, or their thefts. They won't repent. You would think that they would, having heard the fifth angel, last week's video. You would think that they'd have wised up, but no.
And they, it said they've also just witnessed a third of the people being killed.
Lost.
You know?
Lost.
And they still, it still wasn't enough to dissuade them from their wickedness.
Yeah. I'm not going to go on to chapter 10 of Revelation. I'm going to stop here because it's the next is chapter 10 is the angel and the little scroll. It's a good one too. But it's important. What is the sixth spirit of God?
Counsel and power.
It's the spirit of counsel and power. And the spirit of counsel and power is revealing everything we've discussed today. It's revealing it. The Euphrates. Just the red horse. It's war. But as Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. They were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the very day the doors of the ark were closed and the rains began. And they didn't have a clue of what had was taking place. They didn't have a clue. Now, there's a lot of people who claim to be prophets of God who would say that Jesus is full of shit because they claim that they're explaining the prophecies, but it's all literal. It's all literal, their explanations. You know, the earthquake. So that's what's going on in Yellowstone right now. Well, that's funny. The earthquake's in the Bible. The foundations of the earth shaking, what we call earthquakes. Well, the foundations of the earth in the Bible are the Israel of God. I really hope the Israel of God is shaking. But I know that there are a lot of people. They haven't got a clue what I'm talking about. And they don't care to investigate to see if what I'm showing them is factual. They don't want to do that. No, my preacher told me this, I've learned this my whole life. Yeah, well, your forefathers and your preachers and your even your parents were nothing but liars. The Spirit wasn't in them. Oh, but they were loving people, they did this and they did that. Guess what? It doesn't mean shit. It don't mean jack squat. If the Spirit is in you, it's supposed to be a confession come out of your mouth, but it doesn't. Oh, but I believe in Jesus. What do you believe about Jesus? Who is he? When you say the Lord's Prayer, who are you praying to? Our Father who art in heaven. Holy is your name. What's his name? Your kingdom come. Whose kingdom's coming? Your will be done. Whose will? What's the name of God? And people will make all kinds of, oh, we know the name of God, you know, it's something special, it's hidden. Really?
If calling on it is the only thing that saves you, I don't think that God's hidden it.
No, he hasn't hidden it. Just that's don't think for sure. So. That's for sure. He hasn't hidden it. Are there people who do possess the Spirit of God? Yes, there are. Yes, there are. That Spirit of God calls to everyone. Everyone is urged to show love. But people forget that love starts with loving God, the first and greatest command. All the rest of it is worthless because we can't save ourselves. There's no one righteous. No, not one. Nary one man on the face of the earth is righteous. Not me, not you, not Wendy, nobody. Our righteousness is what Jesus did for us, not what we think we can do for him. Are we even obligated to some measure? To obey him? Well, yeah, of course. Of course we are. But if people don't have the confession that Jesus is who he claimed to be, he claimed to be God. He said that if you come to me, I'll show you my Father. Well, how come they don't know the truth? How come they're not preaching what I'm preaching? How come they don't even pay attention to the details? The seven spirits, the sevenfold spirit. It's not seven unique spirits. They're all connected. Because it's one spirit. God is spirit. And the spirit we call God is truth. Who's the truth? Now tell me, what's the truth? That's what I'm explaining to you. Grace, truth, the fear of the Lord, wisdom and understanding, judgment, counsel and power, and fire. And what does it all reveal? God. Praise God. Hey? Should I say any more?
So I think we should just go back again, because there's something interesting here that I'm not sure is readily apparent and that okay. might seem counterintuitive.
Okay.
So again, release the four angels who are bound at the great river Euphrates, and the four angels who had been kept ready for this very hour and day and month and year were released to kill a third of mankind. So the Lord is allowing this
yes.
to happen.
Yeah. Remember, the spirit of judgment came last week. We talked right. about that.
Right.
But now we're at the spirit of counsel and power,
mm-hmm.
the sixth seal.
Yeah.
And there is a consequence. When people don't pay attention to the spirit of judgment, then there's a consequence. And mm-hmm. that consequence is the sixth spirit.
Right.
The counsel and power from God.
So it goes on to then describe the horses and riders,
mm-hmm.
which are the angels, though, because it's the horses and riders who are going out to kill,
yep.
and it was the angels who were sent to kill. So they yes. are the same thing.
Same thing.
But this, I've already explained it. I won't rehash it. But in explaining the colors of the breastplates and the tail and the head and all of those things,
they're all bad, aren't they?
They're all bad. But still, God is sending.
Mm-hmm.
He's allowing this to happen.
It's the consequence right. of man's neglecting to listen.
So this is an example of the verse where it basically tells you that evil destroys evil.
Yes, evil will slay the wicked.
That's right.
Yes.
So, as you say, is it God doing it? Yes, mm-hmm. but in the sense of God's punishment is simply the consequences of our actions.
Yes.
So yes. this is not God, again, being a jerk or something.
No.
Or these people are innocent or whatever. No. The whole point is that people have, we're to the sixth spirit. Lots of things have transpired leading up to this point, and people still are rejecting it.
Mm-hmm. They won't repent. I think we read that. They won't repent.
Right.
Of their sorceries and their right. adulteries and their whoredom. They won't admit that they're wrong.
Yeah.
And they won't ask forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
There is no forgiveness when there's an absence of repentance.
Right.
Learn that.
Yeah.
It's just not mouthing words. Oh, I forgive you, piece of shit. When you seek forgiveness, we best be sincere. We best do everything we can to fix that forgiveness in the person we're asking forgiveness of. We better put some effort into saying I'm sorry. Some real conscious effort. And not just thinking, oh, well, that's, it's all done. I didn't do anything wrong. He pissed me off, so no bad. Really? Don't think for a minute that if a person comes to me and asks forgiveness for something they've done against me, and just, you know, well, I want to apologize, Ed, I ask your forgiveness for this or that, and I say, well, I can accept that. And then the person just walks away. Forgiveness is something that should be preached and taken into as something much more important than what people think it is.
And to include the fact that it says to forgive if you're asked.
Yes.
You know?
If you're not asked, I don't forgive.
We're not obligated to be people's doormats.
That's right.
God didn't command us to be pacifists and not fight, you know? Like, we just fight a different way.
Yeah.
We fight with God's sword. We fight in the spirit, not in the physical.
That's right.
But if you have to ask for the forgiveness.
Yeah. You have to be repentant.
That's right. You know, which also, good thing to remember, Jesus already went to the cross.
Yep.
He did that. But salvation is still not free because you still have to ask for the forgiveness.
Yep.
Jesus already paid the penalty.
Yep.
That's a done deal.
Yep.
But it still requires you to repent.
That's right.
It's not just like, oh, well, Jesus died and so now everybody's
going to heaven.
Yeah, everything's good and that's fine.
Yeah, not quite, son.
No.
It don't work that way.
No.
You talk about Jesus going to the cross. What do you do with this? I won't explain it right up front. I'll just ask you, what do you do with this? I'm going to punch in the word slain. And I'm going to go to Revelation. Where is it? Revelation 13 and 8. I'll read it for you, but I urge you to look it up for yourself and just concentrate on it for a while. All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the book of life belonging to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world. What do you do with that? There's a footnote. Or written from the creation of the world in the book of life belonging to the Lamb that was slain. Doesn't quite say the same thing, does it? The Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world. When was Jesus crucified? When was Jesus put to death? I guess you'd have to ask yourself, who's Jesus? When was truth in an attitude of unconditional love put to death? When did that happen?
I guess the minute we got booted out of the garden, or the minute we, that Eve and Adam ate.
The minute we sinned in the garden.
Yeah.
And ate of what God had commanded, don't touch. We crucified truth. Father Truth, His Spirit, unconditional love. His Son, the form of God. We crucified Jesus right in the very beginning, didn't we? And the scary thing, we still do. Look at this. Hebrews 6, 4 to 6. It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the powers of the coming age, if they fall away, to be brought back to repentance, because to their loss they are crucifying the Son of God all over again and subjecting him to public disgrace. We did it in the garden. We continued doing it right up until God himself manifest before us. We did it to Jesus. And if we continue to do it, kiss your salvation goodbye. You stand condemned. And nothing, not even God, can change that reality. Because it is the Word who is the judge. And the Word Jesus spoke will condemn men at the last day. It's here, yeah. And look it up.
Remember that the Bible says the creation's already finished.
Already finished.
Don't be waiting for God to make some kind of changes or anything, because he can't.
No.
It's fixed. The creation's done. There's nothing left to create. Everything has been set in motion, and it will play out however it plays out.
Yeah. Do this. Get that. Do that.
Yeah.
Get that.
And just something good, I think, to remember. I don't know if a lot of Christians think about this, but certainly non-believers have this thing about it. No, if there was a God, or if he was anything good, you know, why does he let bad things happen? And why doesn't he step in and do all of these things? Well, you want to have free choice. You don't want to be a puppet or a robot. You don't want someone dictating to you and you are just moving through the motions. So God gave us free choice. But in order for God to give us free choice, that means that he has to leave us to our own devices.
Yeah.
He did everything he possibly could. A book of what to do and what not to do, a book that tells us what the consequences of each action is.
Yeah.
He gave us all of the information, but he also gave us the ability to make our own choices.
Yeah.
And if he were to step in every time that we screw up, we wouldn't have free choice anymore.
We wouldn't have free choice. Free will would be gone.
That's right.
And we'd just be a bunch of robots, a bunch of pawns.
Yeah, God would just be a dictator dictating over all of his creation, and we would be a bunch of mindless, thoughtless drones.
Yeah.
And the same people that criticize God for not stepping in and doing things hate the idea of not having free will. Well, I'm sorry, but you can't have it both ways. Those two things are mutually exclusive. You can't have them both.
Yeah.
Either God looks after everything and tells us what to do and forces it, or God says, please don't go screw this up. And we go off and we make our choices. And either we screw it up or we don't. But the consequence of it is it's all up to us.
It's on us.
It is.
It's on us. This is why I think it was Paul said, save yourselves.
Yep.
Believe what I'm telling you. Call in the name of the Lord.
Yep.
Save yourselves. Yeah, that's why salvation is by faith.
Yep.
Faith is an action.
And God gives everyone the benefit of the doubt from the start. I feel like something that doesn't seem like a big deal, but I think it's an error that gets taught in, at least when I was a kid, this is what I remember from church. And I think it is a problem because it gives the wrong impression, which will change how you look at things going through your life. But I feel like when I was little, church used to teach, well, you have to do something to get your name in the book of life.
Mm-hmm.
That's not true. No, you don't. Every man starts with his name in the book of life. God gives everyone the benefit of the doubt. Jesus died for everyone. If you confess Jesus and you repent. But it's available to everyone. Everyone's name starts in the book. Going forward, though, the choices you make will dictate whether your name stays in there or you take it out. Another misconception taught by the church when I was a kid. God takes your name out of the book if you misbehave. No. Nobody takes your name out of the book except for you. Because that is completely tied to the choices that you make. But you didn't have to start out doing anything to get God's love and forgiveness. God offered it freely. All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the book of life belonging to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world.
What is that, 13 and 8?
Yeah. Now this is a King James now.
King James.
And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, that is the beast, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world.
Boy, that... It sounds similar, but do you see a difference? In the King James it says, foundation. Whose names are not written in the book of life. They're not found there. Because they've been erased. But in the NIV, it kind of screws it up a little bit, doesn't it?
No.
Because it says, whose names...
Oh, yeah, have not been.
Have not been written.
Yeah.
And that is incorrect.
Yeah.
It doesn't line up with all the other scriptures that testify to the same thing.
Right.
It doesn't line up. Little nuances. When you remember what you've read in the past, what you've studied and come to understand in the past, then when things like that confront you, go searching, find out what's wrong.
Yeah.
Big difference between saying, well, your name's not in the book. Then you can ask, well, why not? Well, because you erased your name from the book. And in the NIV, it's saying, well, your name was never written in the book. Well, no, that's bullshit. That's not true.
Yeah.
Everyone's name is written in the book from the very beginning. We take it out by crucifying Christ. Yeah. Love you all. Lord willing, we'll see you again next week. Bye for now.